das Gelben liegt gebunden mit der Strick. Hoch im Himmel flieht, das Schwerel dreht sich hin und kriegt. Lag der Wind im Kummer, lacht und lacht und lacht, lacht er um Atoge ganze mit der halben. Donna, 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 donna. Das Geld und sucht der Bäuer, welche heißt dich seine Kalm. Wollst gekehrt zu seiner Vögel, wollst gekehrt zu seiner Schwalm. Lag der Wind im Korn, lacht und lacht und lacht, lacht er der Tage ganze mit der halben.
Zehn Männer, 15 Frauen und 3 Kinder wurden erschossen. 71 Pfund Gold in Form von Familienrosenkränzen, Eheringen, Ohrringen, Manschettenknöpfen, Kerzenhaltern, Kruzifixen, einer Monstranz, einer goldenen Zeremonienschaufel, einem Brieföffner, einer Golduhr, mehreren Goldzähnen und einem goldenen Brillengestell wurden genommen, gewogen und nach Köln geschickt, wo sie im Dom ausgestellt wurden, als Dankbarkeitsbeweise der Dorfbewohner für das Heldentum der jungen Soldaten der deutschen Wehrmacht.
Scheherazade Commandant. The Commandant in Czechoslovakia ran his camp on the Scheherazade principle. Entertain me every day and your life will be spared. Fail to lighten my boredom and you will be thrown down the latrines, into the dog pound, under a train, onto the electric wire. The Commandant could be inventive with his punishments. But the Scheherazade principle was only a principle. Storytellers were not, in fact, in demand in the camp, because the commandant was a xenophobe German-speaking Czech and his command of foreign languages was limited. All his guests were foreigners, mostly Poles and Russians and assorted Balkan peoples, with a few gypsies and an irregular supply of Dutch. He did have three German-speaking Austrian homosexuals under his jurisdiction, one of whom was mute and therefore not the best of storytellers. The Scheherazade principle was adapted to work in other ways. Entertain me with a song, or a dance, or a recitation, or a striptease, or an obscenity, or an act of cruelty against your fellow inmates, and you can live another day. Most people have one small trick, even if it is only employed to amuse children. Pull a foolish face. Fart rhythmically. De-stone cherries with your toes. Speak the Lord's Prayer backwards. Juggle milk bottles. Whistle through your nose. Sing falsetto. Bray like a donkey. Do a card trick. Spin a plate. Count in threes. Those tricks that could be performed visually and without exotic props worked best in Czechoslovakia. But even so, few people can satisfactorily continue to amuse day after day after day with only one small modest entertainment. So these people with a limited anti-tedium vocabulary went to the wall, or rather the fence, quite quickly. Unless they could offer something else. That something else, in some cases, was a little gold. Difficult to know where the gold came from, but when you are desperate to sleep another night in a below-freezing hut, a splintered wooden bed covered in vomit without a blanket, scratching yourself down to the bone because of the jumping lice, it is amazing what resources you can stoke up from the recesses of your abilities. Realizing that his guests could produce such golden miracles, the commandant permitted the socially under-talented to pay off their entertainment dues with gold. Needless to say, in stories like this, the commandant grew greedy, stepped up the pressure, and became more inventive with his sadism. His, as it were, now paying guests became more inventive, meaner, more competitive, rasher, doing great injury to one another, to see another foggy day in this paradise of North Poland in the wintertime. Bring me a ring a day. Bring me two rings a day. Bring me five rings a day. Work parties sent out at dawn to dig sewage trenches near a village with one deserted church and two small farms and a cobbler shop amazingly returned with gifts for the commandant. The smallest dental work of the camp's inmates was relocated. The women's quarters became suddenly a rich, mineable source, and the segregation laws became curiously lax. Even more curiously, the guards' huts were not so completely out of bounds. The commandant, by inference, was allowing his guests to steal from their jailers. He found himself becoming a richer man. He placed half his wealth in the Deutsche Bank, and the other in his own particular no-questions-asked bank, situated in a black trunk under his bed. The mute Austrian homosexual performed his Scheherazade tribute as obscene tricks. He was quite dependable as an innovator. He performed expressionlessly, which encouraged those who doubted he was truly mute to reassess their prejudices. He kept a wedding ring on his person, but not on his finger. One day it fell out of its hiding place and rang tinkling on the concrete floor of the bathhouse where the commandant and his closest cronies had assembled on one of their regular Scheherazade candlelit evenings, accompanied by the very best gold-paying guests whose breath and bodies warmed the bathhouse just a little. Nothing was allowed to go to waste in a work camp. And when the metallic sound of the spinning ring ceased to reverberate, three sets of people pounced. First, the commandant, who now knew no shame as far as gold was concerned. Second, those inmates who had failed to find the day's gold quota. And third, the Austrian performer himself. If the commandant and his eager gold-digging guests had learnt ferocious cruelty that is rarely seen outside the gates of hell, then the Austrian surpassed them. His life was in the wedding ring. He killed the commandant with a shower pipe ripped from the wall, forcing it into his mouth and his throat in a no doubt ironic attempt to make the commandant like himself, first mute and then dead. The Austrian and 49 camp guests were butchered to death in 6 minutes. The fallen wedding ring disappeared. The commandant's gold in the Deutsche Bank was safe enough, but the gold in his trunk under his bed was soon pilfered. First, wrapped in a cement sack, this gold journeyed to Warsaw and then to Vienna, transported in an armored car. It stayed in an apartment belonging to a blind man opposite the Semper depot for 6 months, until it was smelted down in September 1943. All gold has a future and patiently waits transformation. The 99 gold bars were packed tightly and neatly in two sturdy black leather suitcases. Most of them were taken on a 4-day journey to Bolzano in North Italy, where the citizens cannot cook a good spaghetti to save their lives, their purses, or their moral reputations.
Butter Crucifix Gold. This is the short story of a gold bar that was slightly smaller and slightly richer in color than the other 91 gold bars discovered on the back seat of a car that crashed outside the North Italian town of Bolzano, where they cannot cook good spaghetti. The gold bar was wrapped in brown paper and tied with a knotted shoelace. It was like a golden slab of country butter. Brown paper and the shoelace helped to identify where the gold came from. For once upon a time, it had belonged to children in an orphanage in Toulouse. The gold bar was their surety to the nuns who were their protectors, and it was made of melted down crucifixes. On certain saints' days in summer, the nuns would untie the shoelace and unwrap the brown paper and polish the golden bar on their sleeves. They would line up the 46 children of the orphanage in the cloister of the convent, and walking slowly, pass along them, holding the gold bar under the children's chins, so that the sunlight reflected a golden glow upwards upon their faces. The nuns would offer a benediction to each child. There you are, Therese. God loves you, casting his holy light upon your cheeks and making you look so beautiful. God be with you always. May his light always shine upon you. Jean-Pierre, you are truly blessed by the collected power of all the little crucifixes. God be with you forever and always. Therese's grandfather, tortured to death in a Marseille police station, had been accustomed to pick a buttercup from his garden and hold it under Therese's chin. He would say that the golden glow reflected so richly on her face that she certainly loved butter, and would one day fall in love with a wealthy man and marry him. Jean-Pierre's mother, blown into unrecognizable pieces by an explosion when he was 4 years old, had been accustomed to hold a slab of butter under Jean-Pierre's chin in exactly the same way as the nuns held their gold bar. She had said that because Jean-Pierre's chin shone so yellow in the butter's reflected light, he would grow up to be very lucky indeed. However, no luck, no riches, no love, and no marriage. God was not with these children, forever and always. They were carted off to Lyon in a dirty lorry, put on a slow train and gassed at Dachau. Their corpses were burnt. They were Jewish children. They had no right to be in a Catholic convent, cared for by Catholic nuns, and bequeathed a golden bar the color of butter, made of Christian crucifixes. Besides, what was all this? The confusion of faith and money, greed, butter, crucifixes, and superstition. German National Socialism would sweep away all such superstitions, forever and always. The golden butter bar found its way to Baden-Baden. From there, it was taken to Bolzano, in a confused plan to hope to buy away a small Jewish girl, believed to be an officially recognized orphan, with an official German Aryan soldier for a father, and an official French Jewish cook from Vaux-le-Vicomte for a mother. Could it ever have been possible that someone might have put butter under the chin of this particular orphan?
Eins, zwei, drei. Ein Freund, ein guter Freund, das ist das Schönste, was es gibt auf der Welt. Ein Freund, ein guter Freund, wenn die ganze Welt zusammenfällt und sei doch nicht
Peter the Great. A Jewish family in Rostov, whose ancestors had been Dutch, were keen to try to emulate the activities of Peter the Great of Russia when he had stayed in Holland. Through his example, they lathed ivory, made buckets, studied dentistry, wrote the letter R backwards, and learned to inscribe gold with a diamond. Every piece of the family's golden hoard had been inscribed. Rings, bracelets, teething rings, lockets, brooches, table napkin rings, spoons, cigarette cases, fountain pens, hubcaps, and bath taps. And then it had all been confiscated by invading German soldiers. It was taken to Munich, where for a time, out of curiosity, it was kept together as a collection. But eventually, the itemized gold trinkets were separated from one another. The more august pieces found their way back to Leningrad, but some 18 smaller items started to travel in and out of the hands of middlemen and fences, until they arrived in Mainz, and then the smelting works at Baden-Baden. From there, they temporarily, and in another golden state, fell into the hands of Lieutenant Gustav Hapsch and arrived at Bolzano, the worst place in Italy to taste a good spaghetti. In his enthusiasm for all things non-Russian in Europe, Peter the Great had thought of making spaghetti an important contribution to Russian cuisine. He had tasted it as cooked by the servants of Venetian silk merchants in the Amsterdam shipyards. In the event, he took back the secrets of making silk to St. Petersburg, and not the secrets of making good spaghetti. Commentators, determined to make Peter wiser and more prophetic than he could possibly have been, deliberated on Italy, silk and spaghetti, and found the correct connection in noodles, which is certainly manufactured in strands like silk, was probably taken back from China like silk by Marco Polo, and was most certainly introduced into Italy like silk via Venice. These were the commentators who were not slow to support Peter's suggestion that St. Petersburg was Russia's Venice. They endeavored to import Chinese cooks into Western Russia, but these unhappy exiles despaired of cooking good noodles, took up washing instead, and set up a St. Petersburg imperial laundry. The British are credited with being the first to invent, build, and run concentration camps at the time of the Boer War to imprison Dutch farmers, whose ancestors may have taught Peter diamond inscribing. But Peter had predated their initiative. He himself had kept a primitive concentration camp at Novgorod, harboring recalcitrant Cossacks who vehemently hated Peter's foreign enthusiasms, especially those learnt in the Netherlands. A land, they thought, was populated by people with webbed feet who ate tulip bulbs and would rather ride in a boat than on a horse.
Da 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 da. If you have something to confess, do it now. Give yourself some peace.
That was Mozart. That giggling, dirty-minded creature I just seen, crawling on the floor.
Passe vite lorsque l'on est deux, et là on se quitte, voici le couvre-feu. Te souviens-tu de nos regrets lorsqu'il fallait nous séparer?
The Last Apple. Joachim Fingal ate his last apple with his new gold teeth. He was practicing his new bite for the dentist. The dentist's assistant was called Faith. She'd been named after an American film star once seen by Faith's father as she jumped nude with her legs open in a blue swimming pool on the Californian coast in an illicit colored movie purchased in Hamburg. Faith had become a Nazi youth leader. She was waiting in the dentist's reception room with Joachim's files to prove he was a Jew. It was not out of the question that Joachim had once resisted her advances. He was handsome and possessed an Alfa Romeo car. He practiced a new smile in the dentist's hand mirror whilst the dentist was upbraided for unnecessary sympathy towards the Jewish race and consequent wasting of resources. Joachim was persuaded to open his mouth, brush his new gold teeth, and relinquish them in great pain to the dentist who'd just put them in. Faith held the spitting bowl and her two brothers held pistols. The apple holding the last imprint of Joachim's new golden bite was thrown out with the surgical waste from where it was recovered by his tearful girlfriend, Natalie. She treasured the browning apple and placed it above the fireplace in her grandmother's parlor, where it was known that fruits petrified due to a freak dryness in the room, a shadowy stillness in the house, and an absence of noise in the street outside. Natalie's grandmother already had a bunch of petrified grapes from the earthquake town of Posillipo near Naples, a petrified orange from the Holy Land, and a petrified avocado from Elba that had grown in Napoleon's garden. They were lined up along the mantelpiece, desiccated into stone for eternity. Joachim's newly fashioned gold teeth went into a Nazi safe and were eventually taken to the precious metal smelting works at Baden-Baden to help constitute gold bar 557 stroke KL0BB, which at the war's end fetched up in Bolzano, a city on the borders of Italy, Austria, and Switzerland, known for its inability to make good spaghetti. Joachim was taken to Augsburg by mistake. The ticket around his neck read Auschwitz. He was handsome, even without his teeth, and he did not look at all like a Jew. He died in a cellar, in the company of a captured English airman who, believing he was to be tortured and killed, vowed to take the life of at least one German before he perished. The niceties and significances of Joachim being a German Jew meant nothing to the Englishman. Joachim was strangled with a ligature made from strips of the Englishman's underwear. Approaching death without underpants was a curious for an Englishman, but the airman knew that nakedness and associated humiliations were usually on the torturer's agenda, so it might be said that he was preparing himself and anticipating events. Perhaps he even dimly sought to see if the anticipation of sexual masochism could be enjoyed before the pain without entertainment took over. But nothing the Englishman anticipated at the hands of his captors consequently ensued. After the airman had strangled the handsome toothless Jew as he was painfully trying to eat a plate of hard beans, the Englishman was set free. Perhaps he was being rewarded for being an exemplary anti-Semite. Natalie was hounded by the authorities for having been associated with a Jew with gold teeth. Offering her family's money and her own body as collateral, she escaped across France and over the mountains to Spain. She later married a rich Portuguese who died young and left her a fortune. When she'd walked the Pyrenees escape route, Natalie had become acquainted with the sculptor Maloyal, and at least 10 bronzes of her fresh, bold, and buoyant naked physique exist in the world. One of them is presently exhibited in the ground floor cafeteria area of the Metropolitan Museum of Art in New York. Maloyal had once written in his diary that he'd intended to have this particular statue covered in gold leaf because for him, Natalie had been such a golden girl. Without really trying, Natalie and Joachim both left a permanent memorial, the first in depicting Eve in bronze, and the second by making a lasting bite in her apple.
Dein Vater hüt die Schaf, die Mutter schüttet's Bäumelein, fällt herab ein Träumelein, schlaf, Kindchen, schlaf. Vater hüt die Schaf, die Mutter schüttet's Bäumelein.
Violin suitcase. In Prague, a music teacher was forbidden to teach music because of his Jewishness. He kept his valuables in his violin. If the violin could not play music, it could be well used as a safe to house a meager inheritance for his children. Three girls and two little boys and a baby. Their mother had died of puerperal fever. On a house search, drunken fascist authorities demanded to be entertained. They pulled up five chairs and a sofa and sat with the music teacher's children on their laps. The lack of resonance in the violin disappointed them. It was a case of bad violinist or bad violin. They could not be bothered to find out. They played a game with the violin teacher. He and his violin could have the privilege of being cremated together or buried together. Bad music was not permissible in a former capital of the German-speaking Austro-Hungarian Empire. With the children now clustered around his knees, the violinist chose to be buried with his violin. That way, his children might possibly have a slight chance of one day recovering their meager inheritance. The authorities were disappointed at the violinist's calm acceptance of his fate, and they seized his youngest child and made her part of the bargain. What did he prize most? His tired violin or his frightened baby? The violinist was silent. They built a pyre in the buttercup field opposite the violinist's small house and gave him a choice which should be burned first, his baby or his violin. Which was the greatest treasure, his music or his youngest child? The music teacher came out of his frozen trance in horror that such a suggestion could pass through a human imagination. He threw himself at the monster who had suggested such a thing. The violin teacher was shot, and he was burnt on the pyre with his violin whilst his children watched. When the ashes cooled, they went in search of their inheritance, which to them was not the contents of the violin, but their father's charred bones. The imperishable contents of the violin case were discovered some months later when they came to cut the grass of the buttercup field. There was not so very much in gold, but enough to collect, sieve from the wood ash, and smelt with other Jewish Prague booty, and take to a center collecting point in Vienna, and then distribute to National Socialist accounts in the Deutsche Bank, including the branch in Baden-Baden, managed by Lieutenant Habsch's brother-in-law. Lieutenant Habsch collected the bar that contained the meager inheritance of the violinist's children and tried to make that inheritance part of the inheritance of his own child. But he failed because of a white horse.
Das Gerüll liegt gebunden in der Strick. Hoch im Himmel flieht, das Schwerüll bläht sich, freit sich hin und kriegt. Lacht der Wind im Himmel, lacht und lacht und lacht, lacht er hat Augen ganzen mit der halben. Das Gerüll sucht der Bäuer, welche heißt dich seine Kahn. Wollst gekehrt zu seiner Vögel, wollst gekehrt zu seiner Schwan. Lacht der Wind im Korn, lacht und lacht und lacht, lacht er der Tage ganzen mit der halben. Donna, Friednek elbertut men binden unmensch lebt sei unmensch. Wes hat Fliegel fliegt a ruif zu is bei keinem nit kein Knecht. Lag der Wind im Korn, lacht und lacht und lacht, lacht er.